our podcast, we have a very good friend of ours, comedian, Mr. Peterson. Mr. Peterson. I'd like to thank our sponsors, of course, Ray Dolce Clothing, Money is King, our upcoming movie, the director, Eric Martinez, our famous co-host, isn't here this evening. He's at his son's tournament, and good luck to him. This is our co-host, Danger K. Varoz, and myself, Joshua Lucera.
And that's the Focus Podcast, and Matt Peterson. Good job on the intro.
It's Mr. Peterson. It's Mr. Peterson.
I just turned 40, so now it's Mr.
Right, right.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
It's Mr. everywhere.
You said that right when you got here. You're like, hey, before we do this, it's Mr. Peterson. Yeah. So you need to change that on Facebook, change that on all your promotions. Whatever right. you're doing for the show, change it.
Right, absolutely, yeah. absolutely. You know, so tell us, didn't you have a birthday party last night?
Yeah, I did. First off, thanks for having me on the show.
No worries, no worries.
It's very cool to be here. I did. I turned 40 on Wednesday last week.
Happy belated.
Thank you. I didn't feel 40 until Thursday. I felt really 40 on Thursday. I don't know. I mean, I drink less, I guess. You know, as you get a little older, but that night, it's your birthday. It's an even number, and it's an older one where you're supposed to be more responsible in your life, but... that night I was hanging out like I was 21 or 20.
Hey. So.
But, hey, you seem comfortable. You seem right at home. I was there. I saw the man. And Sam cooked some delicious brownies.
She did.
And that was a good time. Mary had a flight of margaritas. Yeah, remember, she had a flight of margaritas. She was very excited about her flight of margaritas. Like, which one am I going to... I'll take a sip of this one. And we were like totally vibing on the muffins. Cupcakes.
Cupcakes.
Yeah, they were muffins. Delicious. Well, the chocolate ones were almost like a muffin. They were like a chocolate muffin with strawberry...
There was like a
cherry upside down muffin.
She is quite the baker, I tell you what.
That was incredible.
Here's a funny thing, or maybe not. So the other day... Have you guys ever made homemade English muffins before?
No. Can't say that I have.
So my girlfriend is a quite cook and baker.
That's a good thing. That's a great thing.
She had an old recipe. She's got one of those recipes that have been passed down from her mom's mom probably. And it's this like file folder of all. Some are written, some are typed. Some are in Spanish. Some are like in English. But she just like whipped through this whole thing. And I've never made them before. And it was... They tasted better than, what are the ones you get at the store? Can I say brand names?
Yeah, absolutely.
Tom
McCann's. I don't think I've had
that. I don't
think
that's right.
They're in the, I know which ones you're talking about, though. They're in that long packaging with the cardboard.
Yeah, the cardboard. Yeah. They look just like that, and they were delicious.
Wow. Sweet gift to have that around, to have that in your life.
Yes, she's quite a sweet gift.
I consider myself like a pretty good cook. I don't cook a lot, but I love doing it, and I feel like I make good food. And,
yeah.
But I don't fuck with baking, like, ever. Like, it's not no cooking. Way. It's not the same. It's science. That's chemistry.
Yeah,
it's like a different, you have to do science... chemistry magic with heat and numbers and measurements, and it's like
to feed sugar to things to grow and air and I don't know.
You know, I've never like with recipes when I've taken my toll in the kitchen, if it says like half a cup or whatever, I'll put just around half a cup. It's not ever specific.
Yeah.
So
I cooked for years. I almost went to culinary school like in 2003.
You almost did, or you
did? I did. I almost did. I cooked. Well, I cooked for like 9 years, and it's funny, my father's a retired physicist.
Wow.
And he took an early retirement because the company was downsizing. He was with him for like 20 years. And he was like, you know what, I'm going to fish, I'm going to hunt. He lived in Massachusetts. He's a big woodworker. I'm going to build things, maybe I'll build a boat. I don't know, we'll see. And after like 6 months, he got super bored. So he went to culinary school.
That's awesome.
This is like 62, I think he was, 58, 60.
That's awesome.
And
I thought you meant like 1962. Oh, no. How old are you? You said you were 40.
Times two. No. So he ended up going to culinary school, and it's about the same time I was starting to get interested in it. And he's like, "Well, try this and try this," and sent me all these the curriculum of all the schools, all these pamphlets, and I was like really close. And then I auditioned for this like movie, this really small independent film. This is back when there was hardly any film here, but I was like, yeah, I'll just do this one thing and then bucket list, I'll try this. I got the part, and then I went like the total different direction. I became part of the crew, moved to Chicago, worked on some movies, and so it was close. But baking is hard.
Do you ever treat Samantha? Like, do you ever like?
Oh yeah, cook all the time. Absolutely.
Nice. Yeah.
I'm with you. I can't. I just don't have the patience for baking.
Yeah. Yeah. That's weird, man. Like, and it's important to have like a trait to present, you know, as a male.
Yeah.
To be like a horrible male. You know, like, I do this though. You know, like, you have to have something going on.
Yeah. I'm going to open your beer for you. Watch this. Look at this. It's got to be a little more than that.
Joshua, he's incredibly trustworthy and tidy.
Yeah.
And so like he's a catch.
Right. All day long.
I'm trustworthy and I can cook. Tidy? I don't think so. I've had this shirt for like 10 years. So.
There you go.
So Matt, our friend Matt is a stand-up comedian. If you don't know who he is, if you're listening to the show, you probably are listening because you heard that Matt was going to be on it.
Right.
And you're Alan Clark. Hi, Alan. And
that wasn't random at all.
No, I know.
It wasn't inside or nothing.
So he listens to our live podcast.
Oh, sweet.
One of the few. We have a bunch of listeners. By the time it gets on SoundCloud and YouTube, we have like several dozen listeners, I think, accrued between the different media. But our live listener is always Alan.
Awesome.
He's a podcast enthusiast, so he cares.
I've been on his podcast. Hi, Alan.
Doing and Howard. Hi,
Alan.
Shout
make
out
sure
to
you
to a potential problems podcast.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure you give us your proper etiquette on our podcast.
I want to get him on the show at some point. You know, and let him and Eric just go.
I'm sure.
I don't know if you noticed, but we don't have Eric. Of course they noticed because we mentioned it.
Right. Well, that's at the beginning. Remember, you complimented my intro?
That's right. It was really good.
That was really good.
Thank you.
Really good.
I've been practicing for a whole minute.
He's going to show up here any minute, I guess. We don't even know when he's going to get here, but when he does, it's going to be a huge surprise.
That's exciting.
Right.
But yeah, Matt is a stand-up comedian. He's going to be doing LOL Los Alamos with me on March 12th.
The one I wasn't invited to, right?
You've been officially invited.
Well, yeah,
you've been invited to be in my posse.
But I had to ask, remember? I just want to, if you go back to episode 3 or 4, I think it was, that's when I had to ask. He was like talking about the show.
You have to create the illusion of demand. That's all I'm doing.
True.
That's all I'm doing.
You're so savvy.
Right.
The business.
this is the Focus Podcast.
Awesome.
So, but Matt is also an actor. He's I believe SAG eligible now. No, he's in SAG, or he's halfway. He's got his foot in the door.
I'm almost. That's.
So that's got to be exciting because that's a whole career path.
Absolutely.
Being in a union, you know, you're a union man.
Yeah.
Union man.
Union man.
You know, like people can't just toss you out like the garbage. You know, they can't just like feed you, you know, weird cheese. They have to feed you like good cheese.
Yeah.
Well, you stand in the crew line with that. That's the good cheese.
Yeah.
That's a good cheese.
Yeah.
You don't have to, like, being an extra is one of the most humiliating things you could do as a human being.
I've done it.
A couple clicks above coal miner.
Yeah. I've done it a couple times. You go from, like, person to, like, cattle real fast.
You
parked. You're like, hey, you see your friends. And, like, go. I mean, it's vital for the film, and they ever do a great job. I did it when I lived in Los Angeles for about a year and a half, and I was working crew, grip electric, some casting, and we didn't have enough extras, and we'd already set up everything, so me and a couple of buddies got to do extras, and it was still kind of fun, but we were those kind of extras, and sometimes you see them in film, and I love this, they're like the super over-actor extras.
Oh, right, like they want to get it just perfect.
Yeah, and you just, I mean, I've worked on some films and produced some films, and you need them, they're just as important as everybody else, but you need them just to do a certain thing, and we were completely those. It was like this horror movie north of LA in like the woods, and we were so far back. There's no real audio on us, but we were just like where the camera was, and we know from crew, like if you see the camera, you're not, you know, you're in the shot. So we'd always just kind of like
freeze.
It's like, what was that crazy noise? And they're like, Scott, what? You don't have to say anything. You don't have to. We're like dancing. It's like, it's not a dance party. You're in the woods. You're running from a killer. There's complete over actor extras.
Nice.
He's had speaking parts in Longmire and Manhattan. It's like if they shot it here, they probably cast you at some point.
Well, they auditioned me at least.
They definitely auditioned you. So you go to a, like, you're an avid auditioner and you're out there.
Yeah, I mean, they come in, it just kind of depends. It comes in, I'll have like chunks where I'll have a bunch over a month or so, and then I won't have any for a little. It just kind of depends on what's.
How are you? How's your like auditioning mental health? Like, are you down on yourself a lot?
No,
Do you come out of some like, yeah, you know?
I don't know. I think I've been auditioning now like 4 or 5 years. And, I mean, that I'm not saying it was a lot, but you just go in. I just kind of, you never know exactly what they're looking for.
Right.
You get the sides and you do, I'll go in and prepare whatever I prepare, and then I'll get the notes and then we'll switch it up and then, you know, hope for the best for a callback. And then,
I don't know if it's the same for you, but at least like when I first started auditioning, like, you know, it's something you're taking seriously. You're all gung ho about it. But then after your first, I don't know, dozen or so, mm-hmm. you're like, auditions, you just go and you prepare and you forget you even did one yesterday. You know, I mean, at least that's how it became for me. I don't know if it's the same with you.
I just kind of, I don't know. I guess I just, yeah, I go in. I like them now. I like to,
right.
Sometimes they're really quick. Sometimes it's just a couple lines and it's just like a bit part or a co-star part and you're just kind of supporting that scene. But I still want to go in and, you know, learn, but I want to have fun. You know, I want to go in and be like, well, cool, with the casting director, like, let me do it again. You want to, let's do something.
Right.
You want to try something? No, that's my mentality. But usually it's like, cool, awesome, you did it, and you go.
Right.
So I used to be really nervous. I mean, the first time I ever auditioned, I didn't get through like one full sentence. It was a commercial, just a local commercial. And I was just like, I couldn't even say like the or something, you know, something so minor. I couldn't, and I kept messing up and you just kind of, get into your head, and then you're like, can I just leave? It's just, it's Tuesday. I left my job.
I just
forget it. Like, but anyway, I like them now. I like them a lot. I like going in and.
Matter of fact, fun. Danger and I were just going over one of my auditions the other day,
cool.
And I was telling him, it was a simple line, something like the, and I kept thinking like, chicken soup from Friends, where he couldn't remember chicken's joint.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just chicken soup. He goes, stars. He couldn't remember. Like, it's something so simple. But when your mind's not in the right place, it's hard to get that done. I completely agree.
Have you ever gone in where you spent? I had one that was just a couple pages. It was a couple big chunks of dialogue, but it was a very specific name of a whiskey.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lot of hard consonants in it, like a lot of B's and K's and T's. And I like researched it and it was close to something. I didn't know if it was a real thing, you know, so I researched and I looked at the word and I tried to say it over and over again. I like for 3 days, I worked pretty hard because for some reason when I first read it, I kept stumbling on that one word. So I go over and over and then I got it and I felt good. And then like I had it in my head and how I prepared it, how I was going to do that, like bartender or waiter, whatever it was. And I get in and I couldn't say the word. I just couldn't get it. And I kept messing up. And then she was like, why don't you go out in the hallway? Because there was only like a handful of us that day auditioning. So it wasn't like a go good and get out of here next time. And
right.
So I went out for like 20 minutes. And I think going outside and working on it again made it worse. Like, I got in my head even more. Because like, well, I still can't. And there's other like actors out there. And I'm like, oh, I can't. Hey, you know.
You're thinking about going back in and messing up again.
Yeah, and I went in. I messed up again. And I kindly went through it. But I can imagine my face was like this giving. I was like, yeah, would you like another beer? Like, oh, I'm just like, like, can I get back? Can I go? Can I go? Can I work for you guys? Do you guys need lunch? Anything?
Right. Makes sense. I know you said you worked on Crew.
Mm-hmm.
I did I was filming up in Santa Fe one time, and I remember I was on a break, and Crew was, they had this. Crew's awesome. I love hanging out with the crew whenever I'm not on set.
Yeah.
Is there was this game they had come up with. You stand on two blocks and there's a rope. Have you seen that?
I don't know.
Okay, well, you stand on two of the leveling blocks, right? Mm-hmm. And then one end, it's a long-ass rope, and you stand on it, and then you have to take the rope as much. There's a lot of it, but if you can pull your partner off, you win. Or if you get to the end of his end of the rope, you win.
Oh, okay.
So like it's a game of give and take, and it's the funnest freaking game. I love playing that more.
Oh, that sounds fun.
Like it's awesome.
Yeah.
And you played this with the crew?
I did. I did.
That's cool.
I was as a matter of fact, it was when we were up shooting. What was the name of that movie? Have you heard about the Morgans? It was up in Santa Fe.
Okay.
And
oh yeah, I remember that.
Matt was also, he's the co-writer, co-producer, and star of Abe Makes a Movie, which we were just talking about before the show.
What's the name of it?
Abe Makes a Movie.
Abe Makes a Movie.
Have you heard about this movie?
I have not.
It's a very funny movie that Please Matt mind. Essentially co-made. Is that a term? They should make it a term.
That's a term.
Yeah, with the other Larry, Two Larrys. Is it Two Larrys Productions or just Two Larrys?
It's just Two Larrys.
Two Larrys. Abe Makes a Movie with Ryan Turi.
Who's our director?
He was just here for the party as well.
Cool.
He was eating a cupcake. I saw him.
Yeah.
But couldn't resist.
So enlighten me. What's this movie, the plot about?
It's like a feel-good kind of comedy. It's about a guy that he gets dumped by his girlfriend. And he's kind of a movie buff in his own special way, I guess. And he gets dumped by his girlfriend because she's kind of tired of his shenanigans, his lack of life, if you will. And mm-hmm. then he decides to make a movie to try to win her back, to get into a film festival and win and make everything better and with him and her. And then it kind of just, he learns a bunch of stuff along the way and comedy ensues and
very cool
hijinks. And yeah, it was a lot of fun.
When are you hoping to have this released?
We're still working on it. We've had some screenings around town and a few out of town, and we're kind of figuring our distribution right now. But anybody can go to abemakesamovie.com to check out screenings coming up and all things Abe.
I've had the pleasure of seeing it 3 times so far.
Nice.
It's very good.
I will have to watch it.
I love Panther. It's like the movie that the characters are trying to make is called Panther.
It's
absolutely brilliant.
So it's the movie within the movie, yeah.
I have Panther dreams. I was like, did I just dream about Panther?
Very cool.
Ryan edited that so fantastic. It's a throwback to a lot of things without giving it away, but it's
cool.
It was a lot of fun.
What do you have anything else planned with Two Larrys other than Abe Makes a Movie coming out?
With the film, like, we're just trying to figure out how we want to do our distribution, if we want to go through somebody else, if we want to do it ourselves through a website or get it online. We're just kind of figuring all that out. So
print out DVDs and hand them out in Nob Hill.
Drop them $5 from the tallest building in town. And just watch it. Yeah, so we're just trying to figure it out. We just want to get, it's for us, it's not like making a lot of money in status. We just want to get as many eyes on it as possible. Just to give it to people. That's the whole reason we made it.
It's your first big feature.
Yeah. So.
Do you guys have any plans? Like, are you developing anything else? Like,
we are. Stories? We have a few things going on.
Are they secrets?
I don't know how secret they are. We have we're writing on another thing, and we have some other.
It exists.
It's forming. It's starting to exist. Hopefully, we can.
Guys are beating it out.
They're beating it out.
Getting some beats.
Getting some beats sounds much better.
You know, whatever you do, it's all right. I don't judge. You know,
it worked the first time to get a movie, so whatever.
Yeah, you know, you get that opening image, you know, get a little bit of Darkest Hour in there.
That works. That works as well.
I can smack that bitch up.
Nice.
Have you written a whole lot ever?
In school. I've never written a movie or no scripts.
No more than I had to.
Right. Yeah, but you know, I will admit that, you know, working with you the past few months, it's opened my eyes to a lot. And, you know, you get your wheels turning and different things.
It's exciting. I love writing. I think I like it more than writing comedy. I think, you know. If someone were like, we'll hand you a career in one of these things. So like, you know, but you had to pick one.
Right.
Like, fuck, screenwriter. Okay. Because I can still I can still be a comedy writer. You know?
They're different, but they lend to each other.
But it's not like, that's silly though, because it's not like I'm going to be in some situation where I'm not allowed to do stand-up anymore. You know? Like, I really had to choose.
The devil's coming to get you.
Yeah, it's like, a lot of fun. It's really exciting. You know, it's like, it's a little creation, but it's also discovery, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like the discovery factor is high. Like, and there's a discovery factor to stand-up, you know? Like, you create some bit. You hear something or think of something, and it turns into a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes you'll be, like, telling it, and then you'll just discover a whole other part.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mid-sentence, you know.
Well, like we were talking about earlier, is, you know, the more, I don't know about the more, but when you have a few people collaborating, one bad idea from you leads to a good idea from him. You know what I mean? So, yeah. I mean, that's always worth its weight in gold.
I think also with a funny thing also with stand-up, when you're working on a bit, or myself, I'm more of a storyteller. Mm-hmm. And I'll do a whole bit for a couple minutes instead of like a quick setup.
Beyond punch. Me how you come up with your material, because it's just so involved, you know, and they're long, yeah, they're long bits, you know, they're long stories.
I remember when I first started, I would just write out of thin air, like things weren't happening. I was like, you know, it'd be so funny is to like, what my perspective is falling by this tree. That's a horrible example, and that'd be the worst bit ever. But that's what I thought. But it, like, that didn't happen to me. So I got to a point after a few years where I was like, I just want to tell stories, and I'll try to not make them the longest thing, and I'll try to make them funny, and kind of, and a lot of them came from like things that had happened to me.
Right.
So I just kind of evolved to this like almost story. I mean, I have some punchlines that I'll always use, or some tag or something, and then, but then sometimes they just kind of go how they go, and I like that more, because I like that kind of comic, like that's like my favorite, because I'm watching them, and as they're going through their jokes or their stories,
you're following it in your head.
Yeah, I'm learning about them.
Right. Yeah.
Essentially, why I'm learning. Oh, he's that. You know. Well, that's he's this kind of person because of that. So it's kind of fun to learn that. Yeah. Why also he, you know, they're up there working through material.
I mean, it's a rare trait in a comic. I can't think of a lot of mainstream ones. I like that. Mark Maron, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, definitely, yeah. But you know, like where I'm thinking the comparison would be like, no two sets are ever the same.
Yeah.
You know, like I don't like. I, you know, you see. When I go to open mics, and I've been doing this for like 3.5 years, and so I've seen a lot of jokes over and over again, and a lot of comics, like you see their bit and it's the same, exact same, and I've seen you do yours a lot, and like seen you do the same bits a lot, but it's never exactly the same. It's never like, I don't know, it's not even like you mix up the order.
Yeah.
You know, it's like you decide on a whim that some things are worth getting into.
Right.
You know?
What I also do, we just did a recent...
Talk about something else. Yeah. You know, like you have these little, like these, like totally lopsided, awkward segues and ways you dismiss things and dismiss yourself. They're absolutely fucking priceless.
Thanks, man.
You should check him out.
Yeah, definitely.
In Los Alamos, you're going to be up in Los Alamos.
As a matter of fact, you know what? I will be up in Los Alamos.
Yeah.
The one I invited myself to. When was your last performance?
This past Thursday.
Cool.
I headlined at a local joint called Imbibe.
Oh, okay.
Put on by Don Sherry.
Do they usually perform there at the Imbibe?
Yeah, it's the first Thursday of every month to do a comedy show.
Okay.
It was cool. It was funny because I went into it, I had all these new ideas, and I was headlining it. I don't know if that was the best idea, but the show turned out really good. From all accounts, like, people were laughing and having a good time. And it was a lot of new stuff, but it was, like, new story. So it was kind of just, like, how you're saying, how I go all over the place. This is, like, the infancy of this idea. So right, it was, like, really all over the place.
That really
like,
was.
I heckled an ambulance. So we were on the rooftop.
Oh, okay. Oh.
But they have it, like, there's a tent over it.
Right.
And it was really great because it's a smaller room. But I think at the end, there was a couple there, and it was like the guy's, her husband or something, his birthday. And he brought like a ton of people. So at the end of my set, there was like a ton of people standing in the back. And they're all close. And for comedy, for me, I love that when you're in a room and you're all kind of in it together. And,
right.
But I was going through my set. I don't know why I did this. Like ambulance or a cop car went by, and it was super loud. And I like kind of hit the thing, and I'm like, come on. Like they're heckling me. And then a little bit later, another one went by, and I said, and then a third one went by, and I was like, you gotta be kidding. And I don't.
So played into your set.
Yeah, it was just because of that moment, I was like forgetting what I was gonna say. So I was like, oh, perfect. It was an emergency. I felt bad. I wasn't making fun of the wonderful job that, you know, they do, but.
The last time I did Imbibe, we all barely escaped with our lives. There's like, after we were done with the show, we realized that this big cooler, this refrigerator nearby had been leaking water, and that we were standing in a big puddle of water.
Was that upstairs or oh really?
It was crazy. I didn't notice. It was crazy.
Like all the electricity and the mic.
And Jason lit his like book on fire. He brought his notes with him and put them down on one of those tables. But it was like the burning tables.
He lit it on purpose?
Some of the tables have like a fire in the middle.
Oh, they have like the gas.
Oh, okay.
He like put it down behind him and it like caught on fire. And he's like, Jason, his like book is burning. And he's like, what? He turned around. And
that sounds like an amazing show.
Waka waka.
Have us back soon. Torching the whole thing.
It's good. It's always a lively time at Imbibe.
I really like those shows. That's a fun place.
Dawn's she's a nice girl.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's
a great host. Great.
It's producer. On the first of every month.
First Thursday.
First Thursday.
Month. Yeah,
I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's free and.
What's the time frame?
Dollar tacos o'clock.
There you go.
AKA 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
Last call is right downstairs, and they like. You can order the tacos from Last Call up at Imbibe.
Oh, nice.
Mm-hmm. They bring them right to you. Fresh.
Nice.
It's awesome.
Have you been to Last Call?
No.
These are places that you have to go. You have to come to comedy shows. You have to go to Last Call. You have to get some tacos. Get the burrito that has truffle oil French fries in it.
Okay.
Holy crap.
We love you, Last Call. It's delicious.
Man.
Well, hey, I'm there. Last Call. I appreciate you reach out to me. You know, give me your free tacos to join your fan club.
I will tell you where to go in this city.
Hey, you're my what do they call the, can't even think of the damn word now, the one they, the hotel, your the people that you ask to take you places or to show you
concierge
around. There you
concierge.
Go
concierge
yeah.
Your life concierge.
No, there you go.
Yeah.
Tell me all about it, bro.
Start with the comedy show to the tacos.
Yeah, you want to go to Imbibe.
Okay.
You want to get yourself some tacos from Last Call. Friday night, you go to Cervantes.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Gibson is on Pedro.
I've been there since I was a kid. That's good. That's good.
Always delicious.
All right. Yeah. You get anything with carne adobada in it.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure you get red chili.
That is true.
And you don't get garnish on it. Or what they, when I used to work there for years ago.
Why do they call it garnish? It's just lettuce and tomato.
Well, what I was going to say is it's funny. It's because a lot of like New Mexican men, they call it salad. And it's so funny.
It is a salad. It's just a small salad.
Like, they don't see any salad ever. I mean, that's how little salad they see in their lives. They're like, hey, no salad on my combo plate. Hold the salad, you know? Right? And I try to like ask his wife for her order, and like he's all like, hey, don't look at her, you know? It's super weird.
Yeah. No, I understand.
You know how it is.
Yeah. I mean, I can relate. There's you know, we have the hometown here, so I completely understand.
That's where all those guys go. They go to Cervantes and they get combo plates with no salad.
Okay.
The place is delicious, salad
or
not.
Amazing.
I love that place.
Or get the salad. Some people like mix it in with the chili and the cheese. And they're like,
oh, I do that.
Like there's no tomorrow. Like they don't even care.
Like, it's all going to the same place. You might as well get it started. You know what I mean? It's all going together.
When you were a kid, did you like your food separated?
I wasn't like, you mean like cut it up, like move
well,
then, it?
Well, yeah, like you can't be touchy.
Don't let that rice touch my potato.
My parents would joke about how they wanted to get me a Lazy Susan. You know, those
things.
Oh, that's fun.
Because I would like eat all the peas, like to the last pea, I'd move it, and then I'd like eat all the potatoes until those were gone.
I did that. I would do the same thing.
Yeah. And I'd look up, and everyone would just be watching me. Like,
that's right. I got your back. I did that too. Didn't have to be so much separated. Mm-hmm. I mean, even if it was together, I'd just eat everything at one time.
Right.
I can
remember in Toys when LL Cool J went off on that? Because LL Cool J was like the military son of the toy master or something. And he was all talking about eating. And I was like, he hates it when the peas invade the potatoes. And he's like, get the gravy and you gotta airstrikes from the carrots.
My girlfriend does this thing and it's adorable. Not just because she's my girlfriend. Pretty much.
Okay.
So she'll... like her last three bites, she'll separate them, and then she's like, "What flavor like do I want to have left?" So if we're having like a steak, she'll have one piece of steak, and then like if it's like some kind of potato, and then she'll like leave a little like, and she'll leave like, and she's like, "So I know when we're getting close, I'm like done. I eat kind of fast, and I look, and she's still like these two or three bites, and she's like, she's got to think about it, like which one am I gonna? Do I want to end with like meat, or do I want to end with like a sweet potato?
Right,
that is so adorable.
It is so adorable.
Oh my gosh! Oh my god! So, So what else is going on in your life besides the stand-up jokes and the acting? What have you got going on?
I'm actually writing my own script, my own feature.
Separate from Two Larrys.
Well, I mean, yeah, I think so, for now.
It's nice.
I just came with an idea. It's funny because I was like, I'm just going to do this short film. Uh-huh. I was like, I just want to write my own short film. Chances are we'd probably produce it and do it together anyways, you know, since we're like in a team together.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But I just, you ever get these, it's not, you're not paid to do something, but you just want some creative outlet, you know, and I don't want to watch TV or this book or whatever. So I was like, I'll just create something. And I was like, I'll just do this short and I'll write it where it's not too big and I can get it done. I know enough people to just shoot something in like 6 months, one of these goals, mm-hmm. and hopefully it'll be funny. I started writing it and doing like my log line and going through my characters. And I was like, you know, I'm going to do like 6 characters. And that's going to be like from the lead to like the secondary, the last guy. Because in our movie, Abe Makes A Movie, we had like, I think we had like with extras, the cast was like 132 or something.
Oh, wow.
We didn't think of that. We were just writing all these characters. So I was like, let's do something that's smaller. But then I started writing and I got to like, and I kind of just, I get the idea. I don't do like a treatment. I don't go like A, Z, then fill in between. I just kind of let it go. And so I'm writing and writing. And before I know it, I'm like 9 pages in the first night. And I took it to some people to see. And they're like, oh, it's like a feature. And I was like, no, it's like a short.
Right.
I want it to be a short. And like, there's too much character development because you're going to have like this much time
you're
for each character.
Taking a sweet time really making it work. Yeah. Like a feature cut.
Right. And then I was like looking at the characters. Even the description of the characters were like.
This must be at the midpoint already.
This is like the very, this is like the next to the, this is right before the third act. And I'm like, to me it was like, so I'm just trying to write this, I guess just writing more, see what we can do. So it's been, I like it. It's kind of a silly idea. It's a fun.
No, it's a great idea.
Comedy. But
I'd love to help you shoot it whenever you do.
When I get when done writing it in 4 years, because mm-hmm. that's, you know how that goes, right? When
yeah.
It's whenever you get around to putting a pen to paper.
Well, it's just you write and then you, for me, I feel like I've written some like regular short stories that are not in like a script format or anything, but you write and write and write and then take a break and you know, look at it for a while and you look at it in 2 days and you just don't like. Mm-hmm. So you take that out and then you add more and it possibly could never end unless you get to a point. But
well, that's the beauty of it being yours. You can cut what you want. You can have it as long as you want, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
So
So you're thinking a feature is what you're trying to write?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I have it all in my head and it's not, I have antagonists set and there's a couple and this and it's just kind of, I could see everything. And
do you have
so
a role
just,
for yourself in it?
I don't know. It's funny because you know when you write, you put yourself in a lot of things and the description of him is like totally.
You're like,
all right, it's like 30s, taller, heavier, scruffy, kind of like, life's kind of not great, just kind of a man child. Like, I wish I had it. I do have it on my phone, actually. I should show the character. Yeah. And I let my girlfriend just check it out because I was just like, no, it's always good to have someone's perspective.
Absolutely.
So I was like, this or that. And she's like, are you going to play that role? And I was like, I don't know. She's like, do you want to direct it? I was like, I don't know if I'll do that either. I just want to
write.
I'm just living in the world right now. Mm-hmm. But it always kind of, you throw yourself out there. So it's always kind of, his description, definitely. His maturity, definitely.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I totally wrote the whistleblowers like that character. Like it was like early on, it was like Matt Peterson.
Yeah.
And you know what was really awesome is having been working on that and then getting to watch Abe Makes a Movie and seeing you play the lead in a movie where you play like a similar, you know,
yeah,
like what we all hope is not like your, you know, typecast.
Yeah.
You know, like where you just end up playing that same guy.
Yeah.
Over and over again, like, oh, this kind of sucks. I'll do it anyway, guy.
Yeah, I'd like, you know? it's, I'd love to play the weirdest thing, like something totally off, get a chance to even, you know, be in a small part or something like that. But when you play that so close to you, it's, you don't always want to do that.
I
want to
see you play like a hyper-violent white supremacist, yeah. Like in prison. And like
yeah, just something.
Like shave your body and put tattoos.
I think
on
that'd
you
be hilarious.
Like,
what up
I mean,
now?
Not hilarious, but I think that'd be super fun to do something like something weird or like a, I don't know, just like a good bad guy, something super creepy. That'd be.
We're actually, I think, the sketchy group, we're going to try to shoot a sketch. We're doing these things, basically, it's like I shoot stand-up, someone's act from a couple angles, you know, so it's cuttable, like a special. And then we shoot a sketch separately, kind of like Drunk History.
Oh, yeah.
Essentially, so we love can mimic show. Words and all that stuff from there. So we find a nice bit that where they're telling a story and really putting words in the people's mouths.
Yeah.
And then shoot the sketch over it. So we did Keith with like Shake Weight and his visit to the gym and everything like that. And we want to, and I think we're going to do Black Mike's next, where he talks about the prison yard. And he's got a prison yard bit where he's got a lot of lines for other people.
Yeah.
And that'd be fun. We could totally make you be a white supremacist. Prison yard. Like, yeah. We should totally do it. Like, would you be down to like shave your head for a sketch? Or maybe a bald cap? We can get a bald cap, because that would be a huge leap. You know?
I think I could have like a flat top.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Would that play like a weird like?
Or a blowout? We can give you like a crazy jersey blowout for some reason.
Yeah.
You know, that would look pretty tough.
I'd love to. That'd be funny.
Put you in a big wife beater and give you like neck tattoos.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can make it happen, dude.
Sounds good.
Let's make it happen, man. I'm buying like I want to buy like a bunch of animal suits.
Yeah.
Shoot a bunch of sketches with animal suits.
Oh man, I'm in.
Just the premise is like, isn't that a parrot like and a frog and a dog or like somewhere, and write a sketch where all the actors are just playing animals all the time.
Well, when you said animal suits, I was thinking about the don't they have like something like in Vegas, like a convention where all these people dress up in animal,
like furries?
Oh, furries.
There you go.
Yeah, I mean, we probably won't be able to avoid something like that. Have to address the furry thing.
Okay, because I was like, bro, you're getting off. Of course, yeah.
That's funny. I love the sketchy stuff. We were you showed me the Keith one.
Oh, I did.
That one was hilarious in the gym.
Yeah,
yeah. We did a show up in Taos a few weeks ago.
That's rough.
What's it? For those of you who haven't seen it, it's on YouTube. It's a skit that Danger wrote.
It's not on YouTube.
Oh, okay. Well, then forgive me.
No one can even see it.
Oh, okay. Well, then never mind.
Creating demand.
I heard what Kanye was doing with his new album and title, and how no one can have it. And I was like, there's something to that. We make comedy that no one can see. And no, we're just waiting to launch the channel because we were waiting for an intro song.
Oh, okay.
In beginning 3 seconds before the.
Well, you can just beatbox into it.
I don't know why I haven't done that already, because I'm a master beatboxer.
That's true.
And
that's
everybody knows. That's why I got asked to do this.
Let's hear a little.
Would you like to?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Name a song.
Oh, man.
I was like, you're a comedian, right? Tell me a joke.
Yeah.
Tell me a joke.
A master beatboxer's like beatboxer. We just put him in his...
How about My Heart Will Go On?
Yes.
You know?
We just talked about that the other day with our other guest that we had on. You were talking about, or he was saying how he was on an interview on.
Oh, that's right. They were on TV.
Mm-hmm.
Kevin Bucket was on. He and Kyle were on KRQE or something.
Oh, Good Morning, I saw that.
In Mexico or something.
That's how they got the speakeasy shut down, in my opinion. They were like, hey guys, we got a new place where we're selling alcohol. No liquor license. Come on down.
The city's like, I don't want to. What?
Okay, like, what?
Yeah. I did the last weekend there. I headlined a show there, and it was fantastic. I'm really sad it went down.
Really,
it was
sad such it went a down, great. It was really cool.
It's a great venue for comedy. Yeah. It was perfect.
And they had a little bar in there,
mm-hmm.
and they sold liquor legally for a few weeks. That was great.
Yeah.
That's
too bad.
I don't even know if I should be saying that. What if I get in trouble now because the cops are listening to the Focus podcast?
Oh, we're such in demand.
Do you have any like active duty officer friends that listen to the show?
I have plenty of. I don't know if I haven't checked their listening status, but I'm sure I could
probably. He used to be a fuzz.
Who?
Cool.
Yeah, it was 2005. So.
Yeah.
It was interesting. Well, I didn't have to shut down any liquor places or anything. So.
We've never talked about that on the show yet, about you being a cop and how that went. Like that's
how it went.
It's got to be a huge amount of interesting information. Like, did you ever have to chase anybody?
Several times. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like, just run, like, stop and run after them?
Yeah.
That is so cool.
Yeah. Well, it was...
That's
I actually took great pride in that because I never wanted to be outrun by anybody. So
and you caught him?
Oh yeah.
Fuck yeah! Yeah.
Well, because you know you have the you have the old stereotype of the overweight cop. Right. That's the fastest kid I ever saw. Yeah. You know, from the but
he stops to catch him. He's like,
yeah.
Oh no!
Yeah.
So, like he got away.
So I never wanted to be. I knew that if I was going to chase somebody, it would be because I'm going to get them. You know, I didn't want to be. It wasn't for some kid who spit on the sidewalk. You know, it was for something more serious.
Like
so.
Peeing on the sidewalk.
Like peeing on the sidewalk.
Well, what were they actually for? Are you allowed to say?
Oh, yeah. It's
anonymous. It's not like you're saying, like,
right.
You know, Richard O'Brien.
Right.
Oh, Richard O'Brien, that guy.
The guy who lives on Princeton.
Oh, him, yeah.
427 Princeton.
I ran his ass down.
That's not a real entrance.
And he cried like a bitch when I got him. Oh, that was the other thing. He's like, I saw a really interesting video of this criminal. It was on the news. I can't remember who it was exactly, but he had a stolen truck, and he had gotten away. He was like a police pursuit, and he had gotten away. And you never hear about that when it happens in the news, because I don't think they...
This was recently?
Yeah, it was very recently. He like got away in a police chase, and then the stolen truck turned up in a ditch, like somewhere between here and Farmington, or near Farmington, or Aztec. And the cops up there, like, you know, ran him down into some field. And there's, like, video on the news of this guy, like, having a panic attack. Because the cops, and he was, like, a criminal-looking dude. He's, like, you know, all...
Tatted up.
I like that. Yeah. Let me stop. The criminal-looking is like this. If you're, like, a bear in the wild, wild Albuquerque, you're probably going to get arrested. Like, don't ever around.
I'll tell you.
They started crying. Once they got him, he started being like, and like hyperventilating, like, are you all right? You're going to panic? And they sat him down, and he was like, and he started panicking and crying. And I was like, whoa. Like,
probably freaking out.
That's what I would do. You know, like, I would cry.
Well, if you're running, it's like whatever. I mean,
I guess my question is, like, did you ever, after you caught anybody, did you ever have anyone just cry like a bitch?
Oh, there was a lot of people that would cry. And there was a lot of people that cry that didn't run. They just cry and, you know, put out their arms, you know. But some of the funniest stories I can remember are, I chased a guy.
That's dramatic.
Right. I chased a guy through the bosque. And he had, you remember the, I don't know if they were LA gear, but I remember the LA gear with the lights on them. Remember they'd flash? We chased a guy. Yeah.
This is like, great right now.
I was like, that wasn't even. And then another guy, it was snowing. It was snowing, and he took off like through this field. And I was like, why even chase him? His footprints are right there. And he was hiding under a mobile home.
Oh,
and
that's hilarious.
We just walked to him. Yeah, right. And we didn't even have to chase him. I mean, I'm like, we can see your stupid footprints. That's, you know what I mean? Funny. Yeah. So
the light up shoes. Oh, man.
That's super funny.
Did you ever, like, you still have your faith in humanity, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Like, yeah. Did you ever an experience in the forest that made you question it? And you're like, oh man.
Which side?
People are messed up.
Our side or their side or criminal side?
Either way, just in general, like, did you see any behavior from an officer or a criminal where you're just like, well, whoa, people are crazy?
Well, I don't know if it was that, I didn't lose my faith in humanity or anything, but I tell you what, there's some, I don't know if it was mental issues or what would cause these certain people to do certain things. I mean, you see some crazy, I remember there was this hotel down on Central, and the land or the room keeper had said that he'd heard some noises coming from the room, and anyway, make a long story short, he opened the door, the room keeper, we walked in, he was literally fucking chickens, like chickens from
Whoa.
The farm. Yeah, he called them one steppers because he'd fuck them, and then the chickens would die. Yeah, it was
right.
I don't know if he was, I mean, he had all kinds of drug paraphernalia and he was high and everything else, but I don't know if that's a mental
That's
issue
unbelievable.
Or if it's just because he was a sicko, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, sure.
But anyway, long story short, you know, we charged him with animal cruelty and other things. I don't remember what paraphernalia.
I wonder how long a chicken fucker goes away for. Is there like counts, like 15 counts of chicken fuckery resulting in the death of a chicken?
Yeah, I mean, there's some, tell you what, there's some
8 years of pop.
Yeah, there's some sickos, man. And you don't even understand where I mean, where half these ideas come from, you know, or what gives you the idea to do such an event. You know, it's pretty weird.
I feel like it's got to be some kind of mental, like, mental issue.
Oh, yeah.
Mental health issue, like something. Like, yeah. I mean, to get to that point, I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably like, several things, you know.
When I was an electrician, I was a level two electrician, and I worked for this journeyman who was a Korean war vet. And he was talking about how they had these chicken fucking shows in Korea for the GIs, where they would come out with baskets of chickens, and this dude would come out and perform, and be like, ta-da! and we'd be like, whoa!
Yeah.
I wouldn't. You can pay me to see that. It's gross stuff.
Yeah, we were laughing about the funny lights shoes guy in the snow, and now we're in that sad turn.
Right.
Let's take another turn.
Let's improve it.
Another turn somewhere else.
I can't believe that we have
not getting chicken nuggets later.
A cop on the show before, because yeah, it's got to be some good stuff there.
Yeah, but let me see what else I can think of. But I can't really think of funny events unless they happen to trip in my memory. Mm-hmm. Like all I can think about are like sick events like that, because those are the things that are stick out. Yeah. Yeah, you know what I mean. So
the chicken fuckers.
Yeah, the chicken fuckers.
Yeah, that's the shittiest thing about life. Is like you'll be on your deathbed and you want to think of something nice right before you go. And you're like, I'm gonna think about my kids, and the chicken fuckers pop in there. Right. You know, and you're like, oh fuck.
That's the one.
No, I don't
life experience.
No, but even though you say you want something to pop up in your head, good. Like, even now, that story didn't come into my head until you asked me, you seen...
Sorry, man.
No, you've been
thinking about it for a week. You did that. That was a smooth move on your...
No.
Like, was there some hotel and some kind of bird?
We just made a big some guy, like... And erased the number and, like, what?
Yeah. Right.
Thanks.
Some crazy party animals.
But what I'm saying is, it's, like, in a separate area. You know what I mean? You don't really think about that unless you think about it. You know what I mean? So, I mean, I as far as my everyday life, I couldn't tell you how long it's been since I've thought of that. You know what I mean?
Here's an idea. Let's do a new sketch show where instead of individual sketches, it's just like a show, like a web series with really short episodes. And we're just cops. You and me are cops, right? We got to get a couple of uniforms. You, yeah.
No, me.
You, yeah. And well, you could be a cop too, but you have to be like a boss. You have to be like a police chief.
Oh, okay.
He's a real cop. I'm
like, damn it, you know? And I don't know what our names are, like, you know, Corky Putis and Guy Banus or something.
Why don't
like
we just call you Danger?
I like how you just had those two names just sitting around. Right. I would have been like Chad and like Mr. John, and you're like Corky Pubis and Cottable. I don't even know what it was. I was like, what?
Yeah.
You just have that compartmentalized in there? That's great.
Yeah.
That's a great name that no one will ever be
able
to say.
We're just misfit cops. We could be some misfit cops. I'd watch those.
I love buddy cop movies, and if you have your own spin on it, because it's just scenario after scenario, and...
What's that? That latest, it was, there are two comedians there. They played a cop, they bought a cop car, and it was a movie that came out not too long ago, about a year or two ago.
About two comedians who bought a cop car?
Yeah, and they played cops. They wore the
uniform. Oh, was it an independent film, right? A smaller film?
No, it was in the theater. No.
I think I know what you're talking about.
I don't know.
I can't remember.
Let me look this up.
Well, I think buddy cop films are fun.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean, their characters. Ryan and I had a idea for one. So when we were writing Abe Makes a Movie, we were, you kind of get other ideas. Because we meet like at least every Wednesday, and it'd be like for hours. And sometimes we write like one page.
Let's be cops.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah, I remember that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then sometimes we'd write like a ton, but then other times. Because you're always writing. It's like, you had this idea for this buddy cop kind of. Our idea was like to have it like the whole thing starts as if it's like the show. Someone's interviewing two cops, and then you just kind of, that's the POV, you kind of follow them. So they're always kind of playing to the camera,
mm-hmm.
and they're either in like a shoot off. They're in a shoot off. Shoot off him! No, the chicken guy! Shoot off him! See, that'd
shoot
be horrible about it. But yeah, it was a good idea. But we came up with all these scenarios. And we're like, it's like, no matter what it is, it's still funny if it's the right characters and the right scenarios.
Oh, absolutely.
Buddy cop movies, I think, are great. They're really funny.
I loved Reno 911 so much.
I love that show so much. I love the movie. I love the show. Everything.
That was like one of my only celebrity encounters I've ever had. It was like I ran into all the male cast members of the show at the Phoenix airport.
Oh, no way.
Yeah. Oh, like, oh my. Like I turned a corner and they're all there. And what's his name?
Lennon.
He was like, they all had their haircuts because they had just finished shooting the Miami movie. Mm-hmm. They had just wrapped it like on their way back to LA, I guess. And they all had their haircuts and everything. But I don't know why. It was just the guys. But Lennon was totally chewing gum. And it was like I was so happy to see him like chewing gum. And I was like, oh, my God, it's the fucking best thing ever.
You're chewing gum.
I love that fucking show.
That was a great show.
When did that show end?
Man, a while ago. I know.
okay, then.
It had to be like 6 years ago, 5 or 6 years ago?
Well, there you go. You can reboot it. You can make a spinoff of it.
It's Reno 912. ABQ.
411. Reno 411.
Bourke 50.
There you go.
Bourke 50.
Yeah. Oh, man. That would be funny. You'd be a good... That would be like in the same way that it would be, you know, interesting and different for him to play an aggressive white supremacist. He could be like a mean and nasty sergeant.
Yeah.
You know, I like to see cool. You be like a mean son of a bitch in a role.
That'd be cool. That'd be
exciting.
Cool.
You know, I could get behind that.
Mm-hmm. That'd be interesting.
Oh, that's a nice fun. Watch.
Oh, hey, thanks.
That's cool. We have one of our sponsors is watches, isn't mm-hmm. it? What is the name of the watch?
I wouldn't have brought it up if I couldn't remember the name, but. Yeah. we're sponsored by watches. You know that watch company?
You know what's hilarious? You don't know the sponsor's watch name, but you gave me two character names a second ago that were like the craziest names I've ever heard, but you can't think of like Swatch.
No, we're not sponsored by them.
No, it's like Cassio. Journey or.
Right now, some tech person should be
and
like.
And then there's like some sort of, and then there's a cream too, right?
Why are you bringing over? This
is one for the books.
Right. Well,
the books published by our other sponsor.
Right.
Exactly. We got the RSP Nutrition.
What's
this? Mac 10. We got the Ray Dolce clothing.
I did cover them.
Yeah, but gosh, are those watch people?
Oh yeah, we definitely got to thank our sponsor, Mac 10.
Like I just remembered. Oh no, I got something right here. If I watch our last episode,
okay,
then someone will mention it.
Right? So how many followers you got on your Instagram and Twitter?
Go.
I don't know. Twitter like 800.
That's pretty good.
Instagram.
Well, let our viewers know where they can follow you.
Oh, my Twitter handle is @m. Matty P, and you can find me Matt Peterson or Facebook /Matt Peterson, and yeah.
Okay, yeah. Sounds good. Sounds yeah. good.
But
I'm all new to this. I'm trying to keep up with Danger over here.
Cause yeah, I don't. I'm. It's. I used to be really into it, and now I did this thing where I linked them all together. Right. So if I'm on Facebook and I'm like, I have this show here, it's just like on Twitter and everywhere else. And
it just
you link them all together.
Yeah.
You get them synced.
Synced.
Then you get them on the cloud, and then you don't have to worry about it again.
Yeah, there you
go. It's like
I think I'm on the cloud.
It has an arc to it. You know, it's like the end of Flipper when it's like, go Flipper.
Yeah. I used to watch that all the time when I was a kid.
No, go.
Yeah.
I like that show a lot. You know, speaking of that, it's funny because I remember when I started stand up. There was like MySpace was still around.
I remember that.
That was like. The thing. Facebook was around, but I think it was still back then. It was EDU, MySpace, so it was very
right.
selective. And then once it got to that point, and this is how like thought of comedy for me goes. So back then, you're really active.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, I'm going to post everything. I got this idea. I got this joke. I got a joke that I wouldn't use on stage. It'd be like a throwaway, so I throw it on social media. And now I'm just like, they got to find me. It's horrible. It's not I should be like, you guys, check this out. But sometimes after a while, when you're like, just... invading everything. You're just like, I don't know. You have to just
chill out with that
stuff. Yeah.
Today's social media, you need an assistant to keep up with everything because it's like,
yeah.
I keep trying with Twitter again and again. You know, I just, I got on Twitter and I'm like, and I don't give a fuck about Twitter. Like, I can't.
I don't,
what's your Twitter handle?
I don't even know. At Danger.
I think you can just put your name in and it comes up. You can still do that, I think.
It's probably @DangerKVaroz. Okay. Yeah.
I've tagged you a few times. I think I'm just barely getting used to this thing. I think I got like 2 followers. And
well, I think it's like a weird. It's such like this, and I'll say this knowing I could be slightly hypocritical by announcing or saying this, but it's like this weird narcissistic kind of. I use it for shows, and I think it's great to see people or see what people are doing or learn about events. Or
I agree.
But when it's just all these like, and there's so much more of that. There, my opinion on this or that, and then the opinion could be like, well, I think that you know this dog breed should be or whatever. Something just very. Particular right. In the conversation, and then there's like 500 things in the thread, and the last one's like it's the IRS's fault, and it's like where do we get lost in this, and right. Who are all these people? I posted like a throwaway joke about one of our politicians that got drunk, and I just said it. I wasn't like picking either side.
You're just stating the facts.
Something happened, and yeah. I was just like. I was just like, who cares? Like, I don't know. It's not whatever. And then I got people I've never even met. I don't know who they are.
They were like,
some sure. guy that like, he was from up north in Santa Fe, and he's like, respect lost. And I was like, wait, for me or for her? You know? And he's like, you man. And then he like sent me personal messages, and I was like, you don't get it. And someone was like, if you're doing a joke, because I know you're a comic, that's cool. But if not, that's effed up.
Oh, what?
And I'm like. I'm not threatened by you at all in your basement, you know, like, right. Whatever.
People
like,
take things way too yeah. serious. Like, there's more to life than your Facebook, you know?
It was fun, and I was like, oh, this is an opportunity to have a little fun, and maybe I'll turn it. And this one guy kept saying stuff, so have you guys ever, this is going to be random, have you heard of red pandas before?
Yeah.
Like, the cutest little...
Oh, yeah, the animal.
There was one that was born or something recently, I saw
yeah,
the news.
They look like a squirrel, they're a little, like they're the same, like tails have stripes on them. They're just the cutest...
They look like a little Pokemon.
Yeah, they're awesome. And so this guy kept saying stuff, and I was like, cool, check this out. And I sent him a picture of a red panda, all cute. And then he's like, I think it just got him more mad. And he's like, yeah, but you can't talk about like politics. And I was like, yeah, but what about this? And I was like, an otter. And then after a while, and then he actually went into like, man, I've done some research. Those red pandas like sexually attack other red pandas. And
oh,
like,
my God.
And they like, they're vicious. And I was like, dude, they're like, 18 inches long. Like, they're not that vicious. Like, they're a wild animal. No one's going to have them as a real pet. He was just so gone. Oh, he just wanted to say something else.
That's ridiculous.
And I was like, that's crazy. Red panda again. And then I kind of stopped. And I actually, like, the day after, people were still, I don't know, none of my friends list. Like, it got public somehow. Because you can, like, adjust on your social media accounts. I don't know how I did it public. I have no idea. And then I deleted it. So I kind of gave in to the whole thing. So I was like, forget this whole thread because I don't want to. It wasn't about me giving them time.
Right.
But I was like, oh my God, really?
But sometimes that's fun to antagonize. Like somebody who you're not going to just antagonize them.
I'm addicted to it. I can't stay away from it. Like, I'll be like Facebook, whatever. And like, ooh, what's that? Like,
right.
You know, I got into it like really crazy with some people who were yelling about chemtrails. Like a few, like
there was a post yesterday or something.
Yeah, the other day there was a really high humidity day, and there were a lot of lingering contrails, con for condensation of water vapor, and a lot of people believe that they're chemtrails and that the government is spraying us with aluminum silicone, and not sure why we can't prove it or detect it. And it's just crazy. And it's crazy. People run around like, well, they're out there doing it. Because, like, even if these people are, like, you know, I don't know. Like, it seemed like they're friends of mine, you know? Like, people that are, like, progressive, not nice-minded people that...
You know, as far as
they think the government is sinisterly, secretly spraying us and that they actually have to, like, worry about stuff like that.
I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't say I believe that. But one thing I don't put anything past the government. Like, I mean, they'll do what's in their best interest. I mean, I can't tell you that it is chemtrail or chemtrail. I'm not that far into it. You know what I mean? But I mean, they'll do whatever they need to do to point people in the direction that they want.
I think I'm just behind that. I agree with you. I think like all sorts of things are happening all the time. And I'm just like, wow, what's in my community? Like what's with my group,
exactly.
My circle, my red pandas, like all, that's all I... Because, I mean, you can go down a rabbit hole on either side and they'll be, and I'm being so general because it could be almost anything.
Right.
And it's just going to go till, like, someone does believe it, someone doesn't, and then it's just kind of like.
You just end up yelling and
See, it just, it doesn't, like, I feel like it doesn't get, no one, I've been in arguments with people back when I gave a shit about having arguments with people. Just because I'm quiet doesn't mean I don't hear you. I'm just like, oh, I don't, yeah, I don't care.
Yeah.
I'm 40 now. I don't give a shit. Right. I don't care. I'm going to go watch the thing on Red Panda's 9-hour episode. And that's all I'm doing. But I feel like, and that's another thing that happens on, like, media sites, is these arguments happen. But no one at the end of that is like, you know what? Totally.
Right.
I'm going to become a Catholic now. Like, that never happens. Like, it's never going to go.
I watched
like,
that video, and you're right. Right. Trails are ridiculous. Right.
If they're doing, if they're making you aware of things, I respect that. You know, if you have a certain,
if it's just information, just give out the information. You believe what you want to believe. Yeah.
And if they're, I don't know, they find an article or something or something like, well, check this interview out or this article, and you get to learn something.
That's what always.
Cool.
What was upsetting me is they were like, the idea behind it was that you can't believe scientists because scientists are bought and paid for. Look at the climate science denying scientists. So my head is like doing like crazy twists, like, so they acknowledge climate change and the science behind it, the overwhelming majority of science behind that, and the existence of scientists that may write papers for coal companies or whoever, you know, it happens.
Right.
Some people get paid to do certain things.
Compensation. Yeah. Lobbyists. It's a lobbyist.
Yeah,
it's
but
the same
there's actually, there's a record of that happening and they're paying attention to it. For instance, it's well known that there's a problem with papers being in China being plagiarized or faked, you know, and because there's peer review.
Right.
People know what's up. Whenever there's a new paper or a new thing, people peer review it and they try it out.
Right.
And so, like, just to say something like a blanket statement like, oh, well, chemtrails are probably real because the overwhelming scientific proof that it's bullshit can't be trusted because there is a fringe amount of scientists who are being paid by a big industry to
say this.
Climate science.
Right.
And I was just like, no, but like, it must be a dark, horrifying world to live in. Because I feel like it makes me think of that there's, this is like an awful overgeneralization, but there's two kinds of people in this world.
Okay.
There's two.
Okay.
That's it.
There's people who genuinely, generally believe that people are good.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the other group of people who generally,
genuinely believe
that people are bad.
Okay.
And I think maybe that has something to do with it.
That's well, I can understand.
I feel like I'm a people are good person.
Right.
I'm like, I think people are good. I don't think cops are out to get us. I think, you know.
I mean, there's always, I don't know, like in every walk of life too.
Yeah.
To overgeneralize times two.
Very true.
It's like,
but it,
that's another thing that you can go out and, I don't know. I can only speak for me.
Nature.
Yeah, you could either go out and whatever you want to do. If you don't like something, you go change it. You vote, you do something, you go into that field, that's what you do. Or you don't. But the people in between that I think that just get to say a lot of stuff but don't do enough action. You know what I mean? It's just do one or the other. You know, like you said.
Pick a side.
Pick a side, do what you want, whatever it takes, and just try to
better that side.
Yeah, and whatever the situation is, because I still think in like our world now, I think our own community, wherever you live, in whatever city, state, country you live in, your community is like the first thing, because they're taking care of you and they're your immediate focus.
Without a doubt.
So you can,
or even your immediate family.
Exactly, like your circles and everything. I mean, you could go out and get bigger and bigger, but social media has this thing where you could spend all day arguing with somebody about something. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. And I'm not saying anything about what your topics are chemtrails.
Sure,
I'm just saying in general, you could spend, and I know people that will do that. They'll be like, well, I got on this morning and, oh man, I've been on this thread all day with this guy and I've gave him so many articles and it's just an argument. And I'm like, that energy could be like, what's wrong with the school that my kids are at? Or like, you know what I mean?
Put
or
it
like,
to something that you can,
why are there
something that you can actually
this,
help?
Yeah, like to benefit your community or your town or your people or anything. Instead of spending so much time over a point, there's a few people that I know personally that spend a lot of time like complaining about, it's just the most stuff that doesn't matter. They're like, you know, that movie was the worst movie ever compared to this movie from 1982. And I'm like,
right.
Well, then don't go watch it, man. You know that show I hate? They start these things and it's like, well, turn the channel.
Exactly.
You have a choice to like,
exactly.
like be okay with it or not. Yeah. Or, and then it's like, how can how can Leo DiCaprio get a, he's just a whatever. And it's like, well, I have a different opinion, but I'm going to scroll or I'm going to not care because I like his movie. Have you ever had this conversation? A long time ago, I had a friend come up to me and he was like, hey man, you ever seen The Godfather? And I was like, I haven't seen any. And I was like 20, I don't know, late 20s. And he's like, what, dude? Like, what? He had this disgust on his face. Like, he was deciding with his face muscles what kind of person I was at that moment. You know what I mean? Because I didn't see this movie.
Right.
I did see it, and it's the best one out of the three. Later, I'm never going to, if I see his face now, it might be a little calm if I say that. But at that moment, he's like,
what?
Dude, what? Like, my dad, like, we got to have an understanding and a talk, and you got to change your whole life. You haven't seen that. So in any circumstance like that, if someone comes up to you and they're like, hey, have you, you know that new song from that new band that came out? I was like, I don't even know.
A lot, because I'm like, yeah.
And then it's like,
you know who does that to me all the time?
How irrelevant you are?
No.
Danger does that
does
to
he?
Me.
Does he?
No. I do not. Crazy.
It's a funny thing, though. It's like, I know what you mean. People, I don't know if I've done it. Maybe I have.
My concierge does it to me all the time.
Concierge.
He's all, you need to go.
And he should be the one open, be like, well, that's my, here, look, I have it here. That's what they do. I'll drive you to the theater. It's playing at the Guild right now.
Right.
But yeah, people do that. He did that, and he was just like, ugh. He was like the bear. Ugh, the cops chase because you're a bear. He was so mad at me. And I was like, ah, dude, no, I didn't see it. And I didn't buy it. I was a little like offended. I was like, dude, relax. It's just a movie.
Yeah, right.
And then I saw it, and then
I
kind of get some of his forced stress, his veins. But it's a funny thing because people, that could be a microcosm of how like things are with people when it's like a topic, like a hot button or a political thing or environmental or whatever it is, or in your community or this or
it's
mental
not always,
health.
It's not always like a higher calling. Like I remember it was a few years ago, probably 4 or 5 years ago, I sat on Facebook. I was on a vacation
That's a good thing to
be on vacation.
This beach is amazing.
Well, I was in Texas at my mom's house for a week. You know, my mom, it was like freezing cold outside. It was like winter in Texas, miserable. And I was like inside on Facebook. And there's like some dude that my sister had hooked up with in high school was on Facebook saying mean shit or something. And so I just started like just taunting him, being a dick. And he just bit down.
Did you know who? Did you know it was you?
I mean, I knew who I was. Yeah, okay, absolutely. That's what, he just got crazy. And like I just spent all day just being like, well, why don't you come to Texas and kill me then? And like I'd like type in the address where I was and like, come get me.
I'm right here on Facebook.
Like, I will.
On the porch.
I'll go. And he ended up saying, like, he ended up getting so mad. He said something about how he was going to rape my baby or something.
Oh,
like,
man. See, that's.
And he was going to like kill my family. And he was, and like all this, and he was like so mad. And I just kept like, and I was like, and I would just like say things about it, like how his penis was small. And how he was never gonna be able to kill me or anybody.
Oh my god!
And it's like dumb stuff, like just like dumb little like you can't kill me. You won't kill anyone.
You spent a lot of time.
I spent all day on this game. I sat there and I felt so dirty at the end of the day.
Yeah.
I felt so horrible.
Like we got to the end, you're like, I didn't accomplish anything.
Like, yeah, it's like
I just feel like
it's like bad karma.
Yeah.
Like degrading.
Well, you're sitting in this weird like. At first, you're like, you know what? I'm going to take care of my your sister. Is that what it was?
Yeah. This
I'm going to say some things because they're going to be like,
right.
This will have a, and then, you get to the end. I saw this video kind of on that same kind of thing. Have you seen these like emo, goth, cringe videos on YouTube?
No.
I didn't even know this existed. I don't know how old they are. I just saw them a couple weeks ago.
Is
so there's these kids.
Emo, goth, cringe?
And what's the, go ahead, look it up. What's the premise
it's,
of this?
It's basically just like these kids. Like, I mean, I went through this punk rock phase and when I was younger and it wasn't like an emo thing. It was like, you know, 80s, it was different. Not saying that was bad, but I went through this phase. But then I didn't have like a, in my room, like a video to send out to the world. Like I'm 12 or 13.
Oh,
who
right.
cares?
Right, right, right.
But now we have this thing where like people have to put this stuff out. It's like really long, some of them, but.
This is emo goth cringe?
Well, there's just like all these cringe compilations, so there's a whole bunch of different ones.
So normally,
but,
are
we gonna watch the whole thing?
And I do kind of prefer like darker colors and just.
What are they doing?
So basically, like, I'll tell you, like, before. So some of them, there's this one that I really liked. It was really funny. And this guy was like, he was like, called himself like a werewolf. No, it's, after I tell you about it, you got to watch it because it's so funny. So he's really upset. He's just gothed out, which I think is cool. Like, whatever. He's just like goth and emo, whatever. And he's,
right.
He's a werewolf. But what I'm talking about is he goes, the difference I think is, and it's really, this is fascinating and horrible and weird at the same time. You like put these videos out on YouTube for the world to see because he was so mad that he went to class and someone that didn't like agree with his werewolf look. Is like, and in the video he's sitting there, he's like, you know what I'm tired of? I'm tired of going into class. I'm like a werewolf. And then he said, I don't care what you think, Josh. And he like called the guy out. He called the guy out. So okay, so he's out in the world. I don't know who Josh is.
Let's be clear, this is not me.
And there was like, I don't know, 50,000 views. And I'm like, when did this trend happen where Chad or
Josh
or whatever, what's, give me an amazing name for a werewolf. Yeah, right. I don't know. Oh, it's like in their mentality, that's a thing. They can go out instead of like doing it through like an art or like, for me, punk rock was like anti-establishment. That was the thing. Right, it was music and it became like a lifestyle. But back then it was like anti this and that. But now it's like, you want to start a band? No, I'm going to bitch at Josh because I'm an angry 12-year-old werewolf. And he was like, it's such a weird concept. He was sitting in like some like woodsy area and he got super mad at Josh. And he said that Josh made fun of him. He's like, what are you going, suck Daffy Duck's dick? That's what he said, the dialogue was between him and Josh. Suck, and I'm just Daffy like, and he like did the emotion. He's like, yeah, Josh, yeah, go to Disneyland and I like do this. And I was like, what are you doing? It's so funny to me.
That's hilarious.
What's in his brain when he's out there doing it and like, and he went on, and then he got mad about his Xbox, and he's like, you know what I think about this Xbox, Mom? And he threw it off, like, way, like, a, he might have been a werewolf. He threw it really far. Like, I was like, that's impressive. Maybe he is a werewolf. But my whole thinking is this is, like, a total train wreck, and it's really funny. But, like, when did this start happening? Like, to me, and I don't want to sound like an old bastard.
No, I feel you.
There's, like, a...
When did
like
a moron kid get to share their views?
And who is everybody else that's watching it? This one has 50,000 views, I think. Or is that 517,000?
Isn't that amazing how yeah, people will just, I mean...
Just watch give anything. It up. Yeah, you're yeah, just yeah, like, yeah. I mean, people have been doing it on some so, level forever, so but now access
emo
to...
Emo cringe is just basically just emo kids complaining of their webcams.
Yeah, they're just complaining about all this stuff. Like, you know, when you're younger and you're in those years and you get weird. You get weird thoughts. Your body gets weird. You're right. Like, oh, I don't know what this is. My voice is changing. And you're a young teenager and you think everybody's against you in the world. And also at the same time, you know everything.
Right.
Was there. We've all been there. Yeah. And you're like, yeah, forget it. I'm going to skate all day. I'm going to write this song with all this guitar. Oh, I'm so mad at whatever. And when you're doing that at that time in your life, you're just like, yeah, I don't want to be around.
Sitting,
nobody's cool.
I remember sitting like in detention in high school, and I had my big black raver pants on.
Yeah, yeah.
And my long sleeve shirt with the thumb holes cut out.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
And I had my black nail polish.
Yeah.
And oh, I had Lord. Written with a Sharpie. I had written Deftones on my knuckles.
Oh man.
Like super
that's
fancy.
So great.
Writing.
Yeah.
And I had like my hair in my face, and I was mad.
Yeah, yeah.
And this guy comes in, and he notices my knuckles, and he was like, "Oh, a Potteresque?" And I was like, "Huh?"
But you said it just like kind of sarcastic, huh? Smacking like, your gum.
Potteresque your knuckles. Is it Potteresque? Is it Harry Potter?
Like, oh, like that's
he's
so
thinking
funny.
Potteresque, like something to do with Harry Potter.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, death tone. And he was like, And I walked off and remember being like, oh, fuck yeah. And just being like,
did you go to high school in London?
Yeah, that's exactly my next question.
Because that was a pretty good.
It's Los Alamos.
Close.
Was he English?
No, yeah. He wasn't English, but he was like super, you know.
Proper.
Yeah, he was like, because I remember him being like, oh, you know.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I think over the years, as I've told that story, he's just turned more and more English.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
And now he's just full on. He's like, he's English because he's. Because Harry, I saw all the Harry Potter movies.
Okay.
Oh, right, yeah.
Mixed with the story.
I like where you went with that.
You know that happens?
That was my next question. Were you in London?
Yeah, no, I never left the United States. Ever. Oh, no,
really?
I spent like 4 hours in Juarez.
Oh, I went down there.
Yeah.
Did you go to have fun or what?
Oh, no, I went there too.
I went down there once back. It was a little safer back then. It wasn't such a big deal. Mine was probably when I was about 9 or 10. I was like a young kid skater. I grew up in Northern California until I was about 11, 12 when I moved here. Dude. But I had like it was a little town called Pleasanton. It was a little southeast of San Francisco, Oakland, mm-hmm. Hayward, kind of in that area.
By Livermore. That's
Livermore.
I go there all the time.
Oh, cool. Yeah. We were just skaters, and I just had a shaved head and just bangs from here to here, and just all the palpera, all the whatever we liked, all our gear, and it was just, just skater. It wasn't so much like a punk thing. We just really enjoyed skating, but it kind of...
Skater time.
You get into that group, and you're like, yeah, whatever the older cat said about my parents. They bought me all this stuff. I don't know how I feel, but it was like, you know what I mean? It was like... And I moved here. I went to Taylor Middle School in the Valley. And that day I found all my skater people. Like all my friends. Like you just know, you're like, yep.
They were there.
Like everybody's a certain way.
Yeah.
And then everybody was a skater, and it was the same kind of thing, but we didn't have like to go back to these cringe videos. We didn't I'm sure we got cringed at. But we didn't know what was happening.
Right.
But this is so amazing to me. It's like
you had no access. You had to have
I was buying tapes still, in vinyl and
You had to have visual confirmation.
Exactly.
Of a friend,
yeah.
Now you don't.
Right.
Yeah.
You can have a comedy friend.
Do you remember they had couldn't tell you what it was called. It was like a little, it looked like a Walkman, but the tapes you put in, they were like smaller tapes that they tried to make.
Oh, like the single tracks?
I don't know if they were single tracks or what.
Was it before Walkman and cassettes? Or was it after they're trying to do something else?
I think it was after.
After CD Walkmans. Yeah, because I remember NSYNC and Britney Spears had come out with those little things. It was it looked like a tiny MP3 player, but it's right before MP3 players came out.
Right.
Mm.
And you put in a little cassette, it was a single, and it'd be you could listen to Bye 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 with your headphones.
Oh, that's funny.
I don't remember that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
That's cool. We had, I remember watching.
We're all sick.
Should bring it back.
Yeah, dude. We're all,
dude, I still got mine.
I think we should probably do a we're older and don't understand that shit anymore cringe video for our YouTube.
I want to see a grown man complaining about his Tamagotchi. It's like, so I came home and my fucking little pigeon wouldn't eat his fucking lunch. And I was like, but I keep getting hungry notifications. And it's bullshit.
Well, you know what adults now.
Be right there!
That happens. I bet we could find it right now. That's everything that has to do with politics right now is adults doing that right now.
Oh man, this stuff is out of control.
I'm not even gonna hilarious. I'm gonna check out. I don't even
Is hilarious.
I love it.
But that's what it is. So yeah, when I saw that video, my girlfriend and I were watching it, and I was like, this is so fascinating. I want to do a study on it, almost. I want to waste, a year watching these videos of these, kids, and, why? You should go outside.
I know. Have you seen Bronies?
Oh, yeah. They're on it. They're on it. They show some of them on there.
What is it?
It's dudes that have parties, but they're huge, crazy fans of My Little Ponies, but they call them, they're Bronies.
And these are all dudes having a party?
Just people. It's like we were talking about earlier, furries.
Right.
They have they get together. It's the same kind of thing.
Here's
they get up and they just
There's a rave at a brony convention.
Yeah.
Red Lobster's Lobster Fest is
no.
So come try them.
We hate Red Lobster.
They're not our sponsor.
They're not our sponsor.
Red Lobster is not a sponsor of the Focus podcast.
We actually have been paid to endorse getting rid of all Red Lobster. Get rid of it now. Okay.
Can everybody see this right now?
No, they can.
They can?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone can totally see it. Here we go with the...
Look at him go.
And look at all the prepubescent boys that left
my... all their shirts they have. To each...
To each their own, yeah.
To each their own, but I just didn't know it existed.
I didn't know
it existed. And I'm whoa.
Looks just like a rave to me.
Well, it's a good time.
That's what I was like. Yeah, it looks like... We went in to make fun of us, and then we're all like so when's
cool.
When's the next brony thing? We should go.
Mean haters. Wow, I think
we're not mean people.
I feel we should go to a brony convention.
Now we're going to anybody out there in the bronies.
Did we just learn to give them a chance?
Sure, why not?
Email is there an email for the Focus podcast?
We know how close-minded you are because you won't even invite me to your comedy shows. So
it's the focuspodcast at gmail.com.
Send us your
brony adventures.
We could. What if we went out? It's not my podcast. I'm acting like it is. But if you guys went out and did a podcast at a brony thing. You could bring bronies on.
There you go.
We could just be yelling over the sound. I think.
Right?
Yeah.
That would work.
Yeah.
I'm never going to look at these people the same way again.
It's funny. I mean, it's interesting.
Eric out of the crowd. He'll be out there.
I could see that.
This is it's an interesting thing.
Do it too. Wear the shirt. Wear the brony shirt.
He'll start doing it. He'll start.
Put it on.
When they're doing their little workouts.
Yeah.
So we're supposed.
Funny.
That's awesome.
It's interesting. I mean, I think it's like this whole.
Oh, there's
this whole thing on Facebook now. Or not Facebook, like on YouTube. You just, it's not solicited. You just decide one day. You know, I'm gonna put it all out there. But I guess, I mean, if it helps someone else in the same scenario, and then they all get together and things are good, that's cool.
Yeah.
As long as you're, yeah.
I'm a comic. I found it when he said Josh. I was like, pause. That's what I said. I'm all by myself. I'm in the woods. I'm throwing my Xbox. You know what? Josh, it was the best. It's the best thing ever.
How do I find it? Just werewolf?
Yeah, look up if you... yeah, look up emo goth cringe werewolf, I think.
Interesting.
I'm guessing those tags are... I think that's how it works. Yeah.
You know what I came across the other day was a. Do you ever?
Him?
Yep. I hate you, Josh.
My name is Evan, and I'm a teen werewolf. And go ahead and laugh and make fun of me, but I believe all of us have something supernatural mixed in us.
Preach it, Josh.
But you want to know what I'm getting sick of? I'm getting sick of getting made fun of, Josh. Like when I walk in to class late. And the teacher will ask why I'm late, and before I can answer, Josh will be like, because he got done sucking Daffy Duck. That's really funny, Josh. Yeah, because my lipstick's black. That's really funny. Yeah, I jumped through the TV and sucked Daffy Duck's dick, Josh. That's what I did. Too bad you got sent to ISS. Fag.
Whoa.
And then you'll take out...
Josh.
Get the classmates around and be like, quick, somebody get my silver so I can slay the werewolf. Well, hey, Josh, look. I have silver. Look, am I dying? Am I?
Oh, Lord.
Oh, puppy.
And then you'll pretend to get fake phone calls from Van Helsing and tell him to come in the classroom and kill me. But you know what, Josh?
He's pretty good. He's got a lot of
I'm tired of you.
You think it's real? You think it's
completely and then you
I don't know.
Scissor hands?
I hope it is.
Look, I brought some scissors this time, Josh. Now look, I'm really Edward Scissorhands. Yeah. You want me to carve you something? Huh?
Whoa.
And you know what my mom
there
did?
99,000
because I told her I was going to make fun of, she bought me an Xbox 360.
Gold.
Saying I need to blend in with normal teens. Well, you know what, Mom? I brought that Xbox 360 that you got me. And it's right here.
Oh, my God.
Here it comes.
And you know what? I don't want to play Xbox. I don't want to fit in. I just want to be a teen werewolf.
That's a good throw.
Wow.
It's great. Okay, if it's not, I'm going to suspend belief. And for the sake of me laughing so hard at it, I want it to be real.
You know?
If it's not, it's genius because it's super funny.
It is very genius if it's not real. And if it is real, oh my God, that poor little baby.
Poor little pup. It's hard for me to believe that. You're not like raised in a cave. It's hard for me to believe that that's genuine, but I could be wrong. You know what I mean?
I'm going to go with it's not.
You can believe.
Yep.
I think I just saw
I was asking you.
Video where he's talking about Josh again, which makes me really question it.
Man. Did you ever see or do you ever watch that theoretical physicist Michio Kaku? You know who I'm saying? The other day he came out with he was on an interview and I heard they had they had found a certain star that was orbiting like near Jupiter. I think it was Jupiter. I gotta look it up, but you know how they detect other planets around stars. They have a telescope aimed at it, and when it comes around, it gives off a shadow, but it only blocks like any planet they've ever found has only blocked like a percent and a half of light or something like that. Well, this one's blocking something like 30%, or I don't know the exact, but it's huge.
Right.
And he's thinking
this is the thing that people were saying, it was an alien megastructure.
Or artificial. Yeah, oh, yeah, allegedly. But he also did say it has to be, you know, extraordinary claims require extraordinary proof.
Exactly.
But I just thought it was pretty interesting when I saw it the other day.
Yeah, I'm very excited about all that stuff. You got that spectroastronomy stuff.
Oh, yeah.
It's exciting.
Now absolutely.
Now they can suddenly tell, like, you know, make better guesses about the composition of distant planets because of the light coming off of, like, around the shape.
Right.
Of the shadow when right. it passes, how it changes the light of the star. Like, oh, it's a little blue.
Right.
It's an oxygen-rich planet.
That's pretty impressive how they do that.
I think that's impressive, but more impressive, we should find out who this jerk Josh is.
I know.
Because he's obviously stressing someone out that might become a scientist.
Right,
that
right. We might have to email him and say, you know, please.
A werewolf scientist at that.
Right.
You know, I mean, could you imagine being a werewolf?
Could you imagine how hard your life would be?
We're coming for you, Josh. We'll see you at the next brony, bro.
Yeah, what if Josh?
Coming.
Like,
Josh
might have a hard too. He might be a brony, and he's worried about this werewolf in class.
Well,
so he's trying to take him down a notch.
According to Zoltar the werewolf man, I think if he's a brony, I think he's overcompensating right now by saying some pretty harsh things about oral Josh.
Yeah, that can be true.
Josh, have a conversation. Send a video and be like, look, puppy.
Donald
werewolf.
Trump said Ted Cruz was actually a werewolf, and Ted Cruz's
points went really?
Down like 4 points.
No. Did he really? Oh, I was like,
funny though.
I was like, is that serious?
No,
I mean, could buy that. You could buy that.
He's a werewolf. Right? You know, he's a jerk. He's a loser. He's an actual werewolf.
He's a werewolf.
Right, right.
He's a werewolf.
Like, rah!
Oh,
I hate werewolves.
Right. Shit, if all the crazy shit that comes out of his mouth, like, I thought you were serious. I was like, really, really?
You know how many people would probably, if that didn't technically happen, right? Mm-hmm. But if you did say that on the next thing, there's probably a big percentage of people that are like, well, I'm not going to say no totally. Yeah. I mean, I looked at his pictures.
I'm not a werewolf scientist.
Right.
I mean, I don't know, but in my formulated opinion,
I mean,
his ears went up.
He self-financed his campaign. Nobody owns him. Why would he say it otherwise?
There you go.
Why would he say it if he's not being bought
and
paid
for? Oh, man. I can't get into it. It's a good show, ladies and gentlemen.
It is a good show.
It's great for sketches and skits. And every comic is writing some topical masterpiece in his mind about it every night.
That's amazing. Like, I can't believe. I mean, if you back it up to days of George Washington and the idealisms for the country, I mean, can you imagine? I mean, the circus you have today. I mean, that's just insane.
Yeah. I mean, it's all. I feel on some level it's always been a circus.
I agree.
But it's just so, I don't know.
To me, like, you know how, and especially, like, even the president today, but all political candidates have social media, like their Twitter and everything else.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is just, what do I know about politics? But to me, a president is not a celebrity. He's the president. He doesn't need a Twitter. He doesn't need to be on talk shows. He doesn't need to, you know, that's just my theory.
But I love it when Obama goes on LA. He's the funniest president. Maybe a president has to pass a funny test.
Oh, okay. He's pretty funny. He's pretty funny. He's probably one of the funniest presidents we've ever had.
Very
maybe
funny
he.
President.
I mean, we didn't know way back then, but he is pretty funny.
I don't know of funnier presidents. Like, they would have said so in history. They'd be like, by the way.
Yeah, it would have been a whole like.
Hamilton was fucking hysterical. He always had everybody laughing.
Yeah.
You know, like, because we do notice things about temperament. We do know about them. You know, like, the fact that, for instance, George Washington was not funny, like, ever. You know, we know that about him. That people would, like, be laughing around him. He'd, like, scowl at them until they stopped.
I would much rather watch a show on the levels of, that would be, if that show came out, like, on any, you know, Nat Geo or History Channel, that would be my show. That would be like, who's the funniest president?
Yeah, breaking it down.
Instead of like, which president destroyed the world and
We're created debt and for all. List. The top two funniest presidents will be here right after.
It could message. Be like pop-up video. Do you remember that? I'm going old school with VH1. And they have that was a great show because you get to learn something about true or not. You get to learn. It was great. It was a perfect show.
I absorbed all that shit.
Me too. I couldn't wait to hear that. Like the and it happened and I'm like, what? Pat Benatar did what when she was 10?
Okay,
like, that
I'm
was
done
great.
With this fact. Where's the next?
Yeah, I can't get enough.
How slow do these people read? Get
they should do that. Faster. They should do that about the presidents.
Right.
That show should simultaneously come out exactly when of the election year, and it should come out like a couple days before or after, whichever president bought that to come out before. That'd be the best.
Oh my God, where does the time go? We ran out of time for the Focus podcast.
That was awesome.
How do we get through this without Eric?
I don't know, but
let me start that sentence all over again. Did you feel uncomfortable?
This is a blast. I had a lot of fun.
You had a good time. That's
we're just
great.
Talking, yeah. Just hanging out, just promoting some things, talking. And just three
talking
dudes
bronies.
Talking.
Bronies,
yeah. And Josh.
We have a message for you, Josh.
Josh, we're coming for you.
Right,
we're bringing all the werewolf, goth guys.
Us and all of our new brony friends are
the
coming for you.
Whole man emo army of werewolves coming for you, Josh.
Well, again, I'd like to thank our guest, Mr. Peterson.
Cool. Thanks for having me.
No problem.
Thanks, buddy.
My hands are a little.
Oh, nice, that's all right. You're in your motion. It's all right. No big deal. No big deal. And
cold and wet.
Tell everybody where they can follow you and your next show. And
yeah, my next show is in Los Alamos.
LOL Los Alamos.
LOL Los Alamos.
Dwayne Smith Auditorium
at the high school. Correct.
Mm-hmm. 7 p.m.
7 p.m. That'll be. It's gonna be a super fun show. And you can. Check me out on Facebook, facebook.com/Matt Peterson, and on Twitter sometimes.
I thought you were just going to be like, you can check me at Facebook at facebook.com.
Facebook.com,
you can sign up, you can get a profile, you can upload an image.
You can spew all kinds of shit about stuff soon.
You can get
it doesn't have to be an image of your face. You can upload an image of something of a red panda, anything.
You can get into Facebook battles with our guest here. And
it'll be fun.
Get at danger at what was your Twitter at danger K Varoz.
No one's gonna follow my Twitter.
follow him to prove him wrong. Danger K Varoz.
Danger _K_Varoz.
I thought she didn't care. Why are you repeating?
Well, I just if you're gonna
have change,
right? Make a contest, well, okay. Well, now that it's a contest,
I gotta
you can add to my viewership. I have like four people following me. I don't even know my Twitter.
I'm one of them.
It's Book of Joshua, so that makes it easy. And I think that's it. You got anything else?
Oh, and also I'm going to kind of check out our film, which we are still figuring out our distribution, but you can go to the website, which is abemakesamovie.com for trailers, info, cast, crew, all that stuff, and anything coming up.
Abemakesamovie.com.
Yep.
Got it.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Take care, guys.
Stop screaming.